Penguin Random House Audio presents Sam the Cat and Other Stories. This is the author, Matthew Klam. Sam the Cat. What you remember about an old girlfriend is perfect. Even the horrible parts are fine. Especially when you don't have anything else going, the memories of her are lethal. In my office, I have an ad from a magazine hanging above the desk. It's of an old girlfriend who is a model, and I've been thinking about her for days. It's been a long time since our paths have crossed, and for that I humbly thank God. But I think if I had her here right now, I'd marry her. All of my girlfriends wore their hair the same way, long and straight, with bangs in the front. They all liked sex, they were all good-looking, they liked the same kind of music I listened to, Rolling Stones, Little Feet, The Who. They all kept up with me drinking-wise. They all had their own cars. What was wrong with any of them? Paula was small and dark and depressed and smoked a lot of cigarettes. Sarah was a ski instructor, too full of herself. She pissed in the bed when she drank. Irene had a knowledge of the New Age and did aura paintings and collected herb tea boxes. Holly's eyes crossed when she got tired. She was chunky and slept 12 hours a night. Boots had an interest in anal sex, but acted lazy and as unimportant as a secretary. I went out with a Japanese girl, Makiko, who threatened to break up with me if I didn't carry a clothes dryer up 4 flights of stairs to her apartment. And I dated a fashion model named Anne, the one in the picture, who was actually bald because of a rare disease. Was I asking too much? I wanted real love. Where was that loyalty and trust? Where were the laughs? Under a rock? Inside a chocolate chip cookie? I wanted real love, not a replay, not the same thing over and over again, not the same dinners, that same let's rent a video tonight. I wanted love in everything, cut flowers, her wearing a beautiful dress, lingerie, seeing an incredible band, blowjobs in a convertible, going to Africa for Christmas, you know, the finest champagne, meeting movie stars together, amazing parties with a see-through dance floor. How many times do I have to hear myself explain this? In the picture above my desk, Annie is modeling a leather motorcycle coat without her wig, totally bald. The weird thing is that we went out for almost a year, and I never saw her without the wig until I opened the magazine. One time she asked me if I wanted to see her with it off, and I said no. See, because her wig was what first attracted me to her. She looked so incredibly hot, dancing in a tank top with this gorgeous long black hair. And what a nasty little surprise when I find out it's somebody else's hair. I get this feeling looking at the picture of Annie, a warm, sour sensation under my sternum. I know what that feeling is, that I did something wrong, and the reminder of guilt is deep and uncomfortable. But it's more than that, because when I look at her eyes, staring off the page and looking at me but not seeing, I almost want her back. It's not a joke. I'd do anything to get her back. If she called me on the phone right now, I'd drop to my knees and I'd cry. Sam, she'd say, would you be my boy? She's just starting to smile in the picture, that amazing wide mouth of hers sliding open, her eyes pointed down like she has a secret. I need her to want me again. Then, once she says I can come over, and later looks up from down there with those big brown eyes that drink you in, I'll want to get out, and I won't want to see her or talk to her or listen to her voice on the phone. What is that, Sam I am? I ask you, is it love? Because if it is love, the world needs a little bit less of it. You know what? I fucked her. She's done. She's dead now. So fly away. I did Anne and her sister and their fat friend. Anne went to Germany on an important assignment. She wrote me postcards from the Hofbrau house. I called her friend up on the telephone. We ate mooshu pork and drank and had sex with my pants pulled down on the lawn beside my car. Hairless and tan, rich and slutty, for all her unique traits, Anne does not hold a candle to Louise, my most recent girlfriend, the only person in my life I've ever truly loved. Louise seemed to really know me and, despite that, wanted to be with me. But she is party to the situation I'm currently avoiding, and so I make do with the perfection of memories. I know what's going on. It's It's all a big cycle. I've had a girlfriend since I was in second grade, and I'll probably have one until I croak. The problem is, despite my current confusion, which I'm coming to, I love, love women. I like to see them bark for me. That's a joke. I love having a girlfriend. All they ask for is a normal degree of fidelity, and then they'll let you do whatever you want to them. Anything. You can have them bent sweetly over the back of the sofa with their gorgeous ass in the air, and they won't say a thing, because the truth is everybody digs it and just needs the excuse of love. I get myself into all kinds of trouble, all that rubbing in the dark, rubbing and rubbing in all those beds next door to a church or over a health food store or in the back of her mother's house. I bet if you put them end to end, I've rubbed my hand across bare stomachs from here to Estonia and back. They give the word and it's a free-for-all. If I were a girl, I'd fuck 10 guys a day. I swear. I'd never want to be a girl, though, for they have the worst deal in history. You are looking at the original hopeless lover. I love it all. The first few phone calls, her hair in a bandana, getting drunk together the first time, seeing her teensy underwear. The normal pit in your stomach is replaced by a whirling feeling. Then those beginning couple weeks together, where you're sort of thinking about it no matter what else you're thinking of. There's no ruminating about what to live for when the alarm goes off before work in the morning. You find a long hair of hers stuck to the sleeve of your suit, and you hold it up to the light. For the next 10 minutes, you are stoned, picturing last night. You take her to a really fancy restaurant for dinner. You go shopping together. You go on double dates. You decide whose house to sleep at. You call her on the phone and then call back. One more thing. One evening after another is righteous. It's nice. You're her boyfriend now. Nobody else calls. She starts to talk rotten about her old boyfriend. You meet her friends. You meet her family. You say what your kids will look like. You think about marrying her. I love being in love. I'm so in love. I'm so in love. Sometimes I don't even know what I'm in love with. I'm in love with the love drug. You walk into a supermarket or a restaurant. Your girlfriend goes in first and you're looking at her ass. And you say to yourself, isn't that the most beautiful ass? That's mine. It's beautiful. Like it's going to save you. An ass isn't going to save you. What's it going to do? Hide you from the police? Call up your boss when you don't feel well? My girlfriend Louise and I went to a party. Mostly advertising people I knew through work. It began late and followed a long day where all I wanted was a simple meal in front of the TV. But I knew I'd hate myself if I missed it. Things happen at parties that your friends talk about for weeks, sometimes for years. You can't miss them. You can't get in on a great joke after the fact. The party was held in a refurbished warehouse. There was a band in one corner, guys carrying trays of hot hors d'oeuvres, and a cash bar. They had a hateful mime walking through the crowd. I was mad at myself for going, disappointed at the turnout, and pissed that I'd brought Louise because she didn't know anyone. When people asked about work, I explained that the mafia had hired me to do PR. I acted like a prick to let them know there were better places to be, but at the same time I was forcing out jokes and clever observations because I wanted everyone to like me. That's why I go to parties. Anyway, people like you better if they think you don't like them. Louise and I started bumming cigarettes off people. If they said yes, we'd ask for 4. And then she waved hello to this girl who was heading up to the bar. I couldn't see her well because of how dark it was, but she stood over 6 feet, with silky, jet-black hair just above her shoulders and hanging around her face. She had on blue jeans and a t-shirt, a high, tight athlete's ass, small, knobby shoulders, so that she was almost cocky-looking, but very skinny with those sharp hip bones that you feel right under the bikini. It was too dark to see everything. I wanted to have a chat with her. Louise, I said, when you go to the bathroom, I need you to check my phone messages. Okay, she said, and I handed her some money. She left. I went hustling up to the bar, wangled over to this chick, whipped on my best head fake and grin, and it was a man. He had some high cheekbones. He wasn't broad. Maybe he could be one of those handsome, pretty male models you see in Calvin Klein ads. I don't know. I'm not an expert on how guys look. Yes, right. A basically handsome guy. Up close, though, I saw that he needed a shave. He probably had had sexual relations with Louise sometime in the past. That's why she waved. He was a skinny dude with long hair, that's all. Not a woman. When Louise came back, I told her. Not that I went running over there, but that when I saw him out of the corner of my eye.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.